Greetings and good morning to you. My name is James Henry Alexander, Senior Pastor of the Sycamore Hill Missionary Baptist Church. On behalf of our beloved congregation, we want to invite you to worship with us every Sunday morning at 11 o'clock a.m. Of course, during this pandemic season, we are unable to congregate together in our physical edifice. However, you can still worship virtually with us via our Facebook, our YouTube channels, or through Zoom. Here you can find expressions of prayer, expressions of praise, and of course, proclamation. Above all, you can find a friendly, loving, vibrant church who has 160 years of service to this Greenville community. We also want to take the opportunity to extend an invitation to you. If you don't have a church home, whether physically or virtually, to prayerfully consider Sycamore Hill. Our doors swing open on welcome hinges. Meet us on the hill. God bless you.
Just Jesus.
Just Jesus.
just Jesus.
Just Jesus.
When your burden,
when
your burden,
you are burdened,
his
name is Jesus.
Those dark clouds,
they
rise, the name of Jesus,
his name
tears from my eyes. Oh, Jesus, Heavenly Father,
he's
satisfied. Just Jesus,
just Jesus.
When your burden,
when
your burden,
you are burdened,
his name, believe his name.
Those dark clouds may rise.
The name of Jesus,
his name,
draws tears from my eyes. When you're burdened and despondent, and you don't know which way to go, let the hand of Jesus lead you, and the way he will show. You can call him in the morning. You can call him late on in the day. Whoa, Jesus, my Heavenly Father, oh, he satisfies. Just Jesus. Oh, when you are burdened,
when
you're burdened, God, I come through this land of strife and war. I'm pleading for your mercy and your spirit that you will show. When I fall, sometimes I fall for the right of the calling. Sometimes falling. Jesus, Heavenly Father, oh, he satisfies.
Just Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus.
Thank you, Lord.
Just
oh, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
When
you're burdened. Oh, thank you, Lord.
His name is
oh, nothing else.
Those dark clouds may rise.
The name of Jesus.
His name draws tears from my eyes.
Oh, Jesus,
my
Heavenly Father,
he's
satisfied. Just Jesus. You can call him in the morning. You can call him in the noonday. You can call him when you want to. He'll be right there. Just for you,
you can call him,
just Jesus. Oh, Jesus,
my Heavenly Father,
he's satisfied. Thank you. Yes, sir. Thank you, Lord.
Go ahead.
All right. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Amen.
Our scripture reading today will come from Philippians chapter 1, verses 18d through 28. And because of this, I rejoice. Yes, and I will continue to rejoice. For I know that through your prayers and God's provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, what has happened to me will turn out for my deliverance. I eagerly expect and hope I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage, so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet what shall I choose? I do not know. I am torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is far better. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith, so that through my being with you again, your boasting in Jesus Christ will abound on account of me. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in the one spirit, striving together as one for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God.
Life. God's been good to me. Ooh.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
If you would be so kind to pray with me. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening rod, felt in the days when hope unborn has died. Yet with a steady beat, have not our weary feet come to the place for which our fathers and our mothers have sighed. So Lord, we have come. We have come with expectation and anticipation. We have come acknowledging that we do have some weariness. We do carry some baggage, but we have come. We have come because we know you have something for us. So we're sitting at your feet, waiting to hear from you. Speak, Lord, as only you can. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. From the passage that had been lifted on this morning, Philippians, the first chapter, simply for a few minutes, want to come from a thought and coin the phrase that has not been heard in quite some time, but I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And that is this phrase, keep on keeping on. A few weeks ago, I was sorting through some of the items I had accumulated over the years when I came across this old faded letter. The letter, which I received during my freshman year at Morehouse College, was written to me from the late Jim Vance, very instrumental figure, mentor in my childhood in New Jersey. In the letter, Mr. Vance expressed his pride in hearing from my parents how I was doing in school, and wanted to offer words of encouragement as I was being in a new space to continue to do well. Won't go into the details of the entire letter, but at the conclusion of the letter, Brother Vance signed off with a phrase that I've heard him speak countless times down through the years. It was a simple phrase, said, keep on keeping on. And as I finished the letter, I reflected to how I felt when I first received it. First of all, I felt a sense of appreciation. One, for him taking the time to check on me, particularly as I was navigating through the pressure of having to perform well academically while being away from home for the first time. Secondly, I felt a sense of responsibility, of the care per the church community of which I grew up in and how I did not want to let them down. But then I felt a sense of knowingness, as while my matriculation was for myself, I was empowered by knowing that I was not truly by myself. And I can't help but to think those personal feelings of reflection and appreciation, responsibility and knowingness occurring during the season of a life where I was physically absent from the majority of people who I came to know and love may not be all that dissimilar to life as a believer during this pandemic season. Because, like my experience, we're in a season of being physically absent from the folks we know and love, having to maintain social distancing for the sake of safety. Because, like my experience, we're in this season of inability to frequent the houses of worship that help to shape our spiritual formation, relying on technology that, while keeping us connected, does not duplicate the sense of community we feel when worshiping alongside each other in person. like my experience, we're in this season of perpetual waiting and watching for the opportunity to return to what our routines were, all the while realizing that when we do return, either it or we will not resemble what we used to look like. And that's difficult. I know this season has been difficult. I know this season has been trying, and for some of us, a tumultuous type of season. However, with that being said, I want to encourage you as believers on this morning that in the midst of the frustration, in the midst of the separation, in the midst of the heartache and the heartbreak and whatever else may come our way, to keep on keeping on. Now, I need to be clear, because the statement, keep on keeping on, is only as good as our awareness of what needs to be kept. Because I believe, if anything else, this pandemic season has purpose not only for the individual person, but for the people of God who profess to be the church. And if the statement, keep on keeping on, means to encourage us to continue what we are doing, there are some things, as believers, this pandemic is encouraging us to do that will serve us well as we strive to serve the present age. Imprisoned as usual in Rome, the Apostle Paul pens this letter to the church of Philippi. He was well acquainted with this family of believers. Visited the area to minister shortly after his departure. A local church was founded that helped Paul in a variety of ways. On this particular occasion, when the Philippian believers, when they heard that Paul was in prison, they dispatched a brother by the name of Epaphroditus to minister to Paul, providing a monetary contribution to alleviate some of the discomfort of his imprisonment. As such, Paul pens this epistle as a proverbial thank you letter for maintaining relationship with him in the midst of his struggle and separation. However, while Paul offers pride for their relationship, Paul also takes the opportunity to also offer personal and practical encouragement as the believers were beset by unforeseen issues. Paul knew per experience how one's walk could be disrupted by both internal and external forces. Thus, Paul is intentional about encouraging the people to continue to live the Christian life, or in other words, to keep on keeping on. And in like manner on this morning, I believe the Lord is offering the same for you and I in this season where we are contending with unprecedented and unavoidable struggles. That this is only but a season. Eventually, it will pass. However, while we are in whatever we are in, God wants us to keep on keeping on. Well, you may be wondering to yourself on this morning, well, Pastor, what does God want us to keep on doing? Well, I'm glad that you asked the question. I believe that God wants us to keep on keeping on, showing our home training. In the first 26 verses of this chapter, Paul is found in a state of distress. He's struggling with his imprisonment and expresses his desire to depart this life and be with Christ. Paul desires this because his departure would also mean departure from the physical pain, the public persecution, and private problems he's encountered to this point. However, Paul also knows that he is very much intertwined with this community who has supported him not only in the good times, but in the not so good times as well. So to Paul giving up would be counter to what he taught this community concerning the Christ that connected them to each other. Thus, Paul declares in verse 27, whatever happens to me, conduct yourselves in a manner that's worthy of the gospel of Christ. Now, the phrase conduct yourselves in the Greek is politeuomai, which means to be or behave as a citizen. As you know, like I know, there are certain expectations that come with being a citizen. A citizen is one who is a native or naturalized member of a state or union who owes allegiance to its government and thus is entitled to its protection. A citizen is one who inhabits a particular location and is entitled to the privileges found therein. Now, I want you to walk with me. Wherever a citizen of a nation goes, one of two things is bound to happen. First, they go, and the nation's leadership reflects on them, or they go, and their behavior reflects back on the leadership. It reminds me when my brothers and I were kids. Whether we were in our town or in our church, folks knew who our parents were. The expectation was when they saw us kids that our behavior would be consistent with whom folks knew our parents to be. If we deviated from the expected behavior, or in layman's terms, deviated from our home training, our parents would be notified and would respond accordingly. Paul is essentially saying in verse 27 to make sure your behavior is consistent with your home training. And since your home, since your safety, since your privileges are found not in the government, not in Rome, since it's found in Christ, then your behavior ought to look like it. But hold on, because there's more. Paul continues, whether I come and see you or I hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, striving together as the one for the faith of the gospel. Now, if you read too fast, here's what you miss. Number one, Paul does not place conditions on when the home training is to be displayed. Paul doesn't say, have it when things are going well, or conduct yourselves when things are not going well. Paul just says, conduct yourselves in a manner that is worthy. That suggests to me that our behavior should be consistent regardless of where or what we're in. Moving on, number two, Paul makes no distinction of change of behavior in his presence or his absence. That means whether in light of or in the shadows, our behavior should be consistent. Now, here's the shout. When I define what a citizen was, I mentioned they were a native or naturalized member of a state or nation who owes allegiance to his government and is entitled to its protection. When Paul reveals there are no conditions by which our home training should change, Paul is also inferring the reason why, which is because of whom we represent. You and I represent Jesus Christ, who placed no conditions upon whom he walked with while on this earth. He hung out with the temple scribes, the tax collectors, and the turned away by society. We represent Jesus Christ, who remained consistent to his mission to protect us through salvation by remaining present to the point of death on Calvary's cross. We represent Jesus Christ, who remained consistent to who he was, to who he is, and evermore shall be. And because the Lord never changes, that tells me that the same applies to you and I in the now. Christ gestures for us to come just as we are, regardless of what we have, what we look like, where we've been, or what we've done. Christ gave his life on Calvary for the world past, present, and to come, which means as a citizen of the kingdom, you and I are covered by his blood, and I take joy in knowing that the words of the songwriter still ring true, that their coverage still reaches to the highest mountain, and it still flows to the lowest valley. Or in other words, regardless of where we are and what we're in, pandemic, pain, and problem, the blood still works. Now that I've said all that, while our walk as believers is for us, and we're not alone, for Christ is with us, we have to be reminded that this thing, this walk, this calling, is not solely about us. Because to keep on keeping on also means standing in solidarity as a sign. Paul says, whether I see it in action or hear about it in absence, I'll know where your faith relationship with the Lord stands, especially when trials come. If anything else that this pandemic has done, it has forced us to consider how, not how much, but how we place value in the entity we call church. Because, let's be honest, when we hear the word church spoken, most of us think of a building first. Pulpit pews, crosses, instruments, stained glass windows, so forth and so on. We think of the place where we physically gather to praise God and to be present in community with one another. That's what we think of. But per the pandemic, we're unable to gather in the church buildings for the foreseeable future. And our response to that says a lot, I believe, about what our value drivers are concerning church. I've read and I've heard folks all over the country, not this church, but folks all over the country respond as such: I can't live without the church. I risk life and limb to get into the building and sit in the church. What am I gonna do without the church? And I get it. I miss gathering together. I miss seeing certain faces. I miss the laughter. I miss the tears. I miss worshiping together. But the church is not the building. The church is not brick and mortar, pulpit and pews, stained glass windows and icons. The church is not the fellowship hall, nor the classrooms, nor a family life center, nor the silver and gold. The church is a collective of believers who stand on the promise of God, who stand in the power of the Holy Spirit, and stand firm as an accurate portrait of Christ, who was present for all God's children. And since the church is not restricted to the building, then the church should not be bound by the restrictions of this pandemic. Or in other words, the work of the church can't stop because we can't get in the church. The work of the church can't stop because the church ought to be in us. And that's at the heart of what Paul is offering to the Philippian community in the text, and what he's offering to you and I in the next.
now that there will be opposition. There will be adversarial forces that will attempt to deter and disrupt the work of God from meeting those who are standing in the need. And these adversarial forces will use what they can to shake us up and strike us down. They will use the inability to get in a building as an excuse to say, God ain't with you. They will use acts of discrimination and dirty political tactics as a means to justify the long simmering inequality and inequity that persists in this land. They will use the feelings of isolation and fear that we may feel of catching this crippling disease to keep us enshrouded in depression and despair. But I heard Paul say that the church I know, the believers who are blood bought and bound together as the body of Christ, they know that such is the time to take a stand and withstand all of the forces that come our way. I heard Paul say that even if we're not in one place, that don't stop us from being in one accord. Good day, church. May the Lord bless and keep you. But if Paul reminds the believers of all the things that the Lord says to the church in encouragement as it encounters opposition, then the church, as citizens of the kingdom of God, the church as the conduit between the people and the power, the church as they who learn divine home training must stand up as a sign to those who are suffering, to those who are weary, to those who are burdened, bruised and battered, to keep on keeping on, keep on keeping on in times of isolation, because the Lord reminds us no temptation has overtaken you except what is common to mankind. But God is faithful. He will not let you be tempted beyond what you can bear. But when you are tempted, he will provide a way out so that you can endure it. Keep on keeping on in times of exhaustion. Let us not lose heart in doing good, for in due time we will reap if we don't grow weary. He will tell us to keep on keeping on in times of concern over the Lord, if he can or if he will do something about what we're in. For he is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in all things hold together. I heard him say, keep on keeping on in times of confusion. He will keep keep us in perfect peace. Those whose minds are stayed on him because they trust in him. Keep on keeping on in times of famine. For I heard the Lord say, my God shall supply all of our needs according to his riches and glory. Let the redeemed of the Lord, let the citizens of the Lord, let the people in solidarity say so. Or in other words, keep on keeping on, keep on keeping on. When the road gets rough, keep on keeping on. When the going gets tough, keep on keeping on. When darkness descends like a fog, you keep on keeping on. In the midst of your health, in the midst of your finances, in the midst of your schools, in the midst of your pain, keep on, keep on, keep on. So you ought to keep on keeping on, first of all, because you're not in this thing by yourself. God is with us everywhere we go, every turn. Some days it may not feel like it because we're looking for God in the major things. But God majors in minor moves. God is present. God shows evidence of where God is at all times. But secondly, you ought to keep on keeping on because God has equipped us for such a time as this. There are folks who are depending on us, folks who have yet to meet us. And God has birthed something in us. God has imparted something to us. Paul says, for we have these treasures in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power of God may be of God and not of ourselves. We have access to this, but it's not for us. I mean, on one hand, let me be clear, God's working through us, God's blessing us in the midst of all this. But God has called us to serve, to reach out, to stretch out to our brothers and sisters who are also going through. And the only way we could do that in the midst of everything that's going on is to keep on keeping on. I know the road gets rough. I know this season is a rough season. I know this season is one in which we have been stretched beyond our comfort zone, and in some cases, we have been stretched beyond our breaking point. But that's the reason, number one, to place your hope and trust in God. You don't need to be in the physical church building to connect and commune with God. You could pray wherever you are. You could praise wherever you are. Whether it's your closet, your living room, your recliner, your bedroom, your backyard, your garden, your bathroom, wherever you may be, God is not distant from you where God can't get to you. Number two, perhaps God's stretching in this season is to help us to redefine where our relationship with God is. Because the church and God are mutually exclusive. They can't be the same God at the same time. Now, let me explain that. Scripture reminds us you can't serve two masters. Sometimes we become so church-oriented that we omit God from our lives. There's a such thing as worshiping the church and missing God. So now we are being forced outside of our buildings, not to redefine what the church is, but to read and remind ourselves who the church is. A body of believers who have been charged by the Lord to go ye therefore into the nations, teach, baptize, share the liberating gospel of Jesus Christ. So I want to extend the invitation to you. We extend this invitation every Sunday, and we will continue to do so until the Lord returns. And this is an invitation, first of all, an invitation to discipleship. The reason why that letter carried so much importance to me, and I still have it to this day, was because of the relationship I had with Jim Vance. As a mentor, as a man of God, as a servant, as one who has been faithful to the church and to Christ, I appreciated his words because I was invested in him. He demonstrated those words in action. That was the relationship. God wants the same relationship with you, that when God speaks, God's words absorb into you, and you know they're coming from a loving place. Now that comes through God's ultimate word, which is the word made flesh, his son, Jesus Christ. So if you really want to keep on keeping on in the midst of everything, we want to introduce you to the one who has done it, kept on keeping on to the point of death, and still overcame it. Second invitation is an invitation for community. Even though we are physically separate, we can still stand on one accord, trusting and believing that God will take care of us. Now, you don't want to attempt to exist in isolation, because isolation is not only a lonely place, but it's a place in which the enemy will attack you. And the enemy got a full army. So why not align yourself with an army under the kingdom that has been called to be more than conquerors, as Paul would say. And we recommend no better place than here at 1001 Hooker Road, Sycamore Hill. For 160 years, we have been prayer warriors. We have been praise partners. We have participated in each other's joys, and with tender sympathy bore one another's burdens and sorrows. And we want you to be part of our family. So if by chance you are ready to give your life to Christ through discipleship, or if you want to join and link up with this fellowship, we urge you, we invite you to reach out and contact us per the information that is shown on the screen. And one of our members will return your contact promptly, and we'll connect with you that we may be able to tell you about how God moves in the life of this community. God bless you. The doors of the church are open.
Yeah.
Won't he provide? Won't he do it? Won't he do it?